question and lament. How long, he asks, should I cry out for help? The prophet is in distress, and he's fed up with it. For Habakkuk, it appears that God has not reached out to save him. God has not taken a look at his trouble. The prophet's laments are not just of a personal matter. The larger systems of his communities have failed him. The law becomes slack, and also justice never seems to prevail for Habakkuk. The wicked are getting ahead of the righteous. Surely, that state of affairs is not what God intended. In the world around us, there are moments of beauty and inbreakings of the kingdom of God, but there is also pain and injustice. The powerful and the strong so often win at the expense of the weak. Habakkuk cries out because the state of his world makes it seem that God is not listening. So Habakkuk reaches out to God with an honest pain and questioning in today's readings. He waits for an answer. Of course, the answer in today's reading comes in the next verse, but we don't really know how long Habakkuk had to wait. Waiting in silence is difficult. Also, waiting with others in their own silence is difficult. But the waiting brings an answer for Habakkuk. The Lord answers Habakkuk, the vision. Habakkuk has raised large questions about the existence of pain and evil. What appears to be important to Habakkuk is the fact that God speaks and replies. The silence has been broken. What God has to say is not maybe a direct answer to Habakkuk's lament, but it is a start of a conversation. Another conversation is taking place this morning. Zacchaeus, come down from there. Guess who's coming to dinner? I am. Zacchaeus, you wanted to see Jesus? Well, you get to see Jesus. Ah, and then the grumbling starts. Jesus, this is Zacchaeus. I mean, I know that you know his name, but are you sure this is the person's house you want to go to? I mean, do you know his background, his occupation, his reputation? You're supposed to be a pious teacher, Jesus. And this Zacchaeus, I don't know. You want to go be a guest at his home? A tax collector? And last week, we encountered another tax collector, correct? Are you with me? Yeah. This week, again, this is the chief tax collector. Woo! Working for the enemy. Roman occupation. And beyond that, everybody knew that the tax collectors were dishonest. Lying in their own pockets, skimming money from the top, overcharging, ridiculous interest rates. And besides being looked down upon, literally, he was short of stature. So alas, Zacchaeus was not having a good time in his community, let alone being taken seriously by his community. So I can appreciate the grumbling today. Really, Jesus? That's the person you're going to go have dinner with. What an opportunity. What a breaking through of our Lord. That he invites himself over to someone's house, someone like this. And what warms my heart is that Zacchaeus, today's translation says happy, but Zacchaeus receives our Lord joyfully. Zacchaeus is happy to see Jesus up close and personal. Not only just that, when he receives him joyfully, our Lord brings forgiveness to his house. Because what does he do? You know, those people I overcharged, I'm going to pay them back four times. He embraces himself and what he did, and he put it all out on the table. Thank God for Zacchaeus' joy. Behold, the Lord, half of my goods I give to the poor, and if I defrauded anyone of anything, I will restore it fourfold. Repentance in action. Zacchaeus comes to grip with his own brokenness and how he's hurt people. And he acknowledges that, and he turns away from it. Our Lord has this effect on people, even through repentance. And we know this is going to cost Zacchaeus quite a bit and a bundle of money. But he's glad to be free. He's glad to live freely. I can almost appreciate the midrash of the rabbis back in the day, maybe. You know, well, Lord, how much do I need to give? Give away everything. Give away everything. And you can hear the acceptance going, okay, Lord, I'm going to do it. And then our Lord goes, actually, 10% is fine. I was just checking to see if you're in with me all the way. And what Zacchaeus is receiving today from me, from Jesus, is far worth more than any money in the world. Forgiveness. And it strikes me, the joy that Zacchaeus receives this with. What a challenge today, friends, for the church, for our communities. What does joy look like today? We claim to celebrate the great Thanksgiving. And I give thanks to St. Mary, because you want to experience joy. If you're visiting us today, when we get to the peace, you will experience joy. Because it is people interacting with one another, knowing each other by name, sharing their stories. Community gathered brings joy. Yesterday we celebrated the life of Terry Smith, a parishioner I did not know at St. Mary's. But the constant thread of all the stories I heard from everyone is his life of joy. What destroys joy? Fear. Fear sits deep within us all. We are afraid of so many things. The dark, the discovery of our secret faults and flaws, sickness, pain, loss of money, or prestige, or reputation, or even death itself. Are you with me? Fear confines us. And thus we struggle, I think, to live out God's dream of what it means to be the human family. So right about now, anybody who's on the internet watching this is probably thinking to themselves, ah, Father Mackenzie writing a sermon. There he goes again. What? Then welcome to the real world, Lester. Welcome to the real world, Father Mack, of pain. Talking about, do not be afraid. Look at the Acts of the Apostles. They were on the door of death. Denied this Jesus, and they said no, and they didn't. Rejoicing. Look at South Africa. Nancy Doden, yama febo. Nancy Doden, yama febo. Paso, paso, padoden, yama febo. Sounds like a fun song, right?
Yeah.
Sounds like a joyful song, right? Oh, painful song. A painful song sung by the mothers on the streets to a president, a prime minister at the time, Verwoerd, who was called the architect of apartheid. And the song says, watch out, beware, Verwoerd! Things will change. Even in the midst of deep pain, there was joy. The Acts of the Apostles showcase this to us. My own life, I've seen it happen. And I'm sure in your lives, somewhere, when it was the valley moment, you had the courage to find your alleluia. And so I give thanks to God for the joy of Zacchaeus, who takes a risk and climbs up his sycamore tree because he wants to see Jesus, because he knows his life will never be the same again. Oh, fear sits deep within us, each of us. us. We are afraid of so many things. Fear keeps us even from trusting other people, trying new things, even from joy. Fear paralyzes our ability to live out God's dream of joy. True joy, what is that? Defined by the great C.S. Lewis, joy, a desire which is more fulfilling and delightful than the possession of any other good. Today, this week, let us embrace the joy of Christ visiting our hearts and our homes. Climb up your sycamore tree with me and let Christ see you and me, the authentic self. And let us accept who we are called to be in the heart of God. What does the creation story say? And it was good. How will you and I live deeper in joy this week, friends? 20 seconds to tell your neighbor how you're going to do that.